talked about food security issues, especially with climate change, that they're saying by 2040, 2050 range, there could be kind of a global famine, and that a lot of our regular crops may not produce. And so I was wondering, in terms of funding for public funding for agricultural research, because I was talking to John Sulik from Guelph Agroecology, and they were saying that they only get privately funded, and the private funding is basically just milking the farmers.
Sure, great question. So two parts. Go ahead.
One last part was that I just had kind of this idea of edible food forest domes as a kind of a housing. Well, it meets all basic needs in terms of you can have all of your food, your water, your energy, and community needs within a 15-meter radius by having a food forest.
Yeah, great. Okay, all fantastic questions. So first of all, I will say there is public research for agriculture. And I can say that I know that because I'm an MPP who represents the University of Guelph, which receives most of that funding. Some of it's not always oriented towards sustainable agriculture or agroecology or regenerative agriculture, but there is public money going into agriculture. And one of the promising, and I say, I'm going to say this as somebody, I grew up on a conventional farm. My parents, we cash cropped and raised cattle. And so, you know, it was a pretty large farm, 2,000 acres. So, you know, we're like fairly big farm. And I also started one of Ontario's first local organic food businesses and have operated a number of organic food businesses. So I'm one of these people who sort of worked on both sides of the debate between conventional and organic agriculture. And there's some, I think, some really promising technological advances that are happening. A lot of it coming out of the University of Guelph. That is starting to narrow the divide between conventional and organic agriculture. A lot of it's called precision agriculture, where you're actually looking at using soil testing combined with GPS data to significantly reduce the amount of pesticides and fertilizers that farmers in the conventional sector use. And farmers like it because you save money. Like, who wants to spend money on it? Like, most farmers don't want to spend money on these chemicals, but they kind of have to due to market conditions. So here's a way to actually use technology to significantly reduce chemical inputs while still maintaining and even increasing yields. So there are some advances happening. There's also some huge advances happening within regenerative agriculture, organic agriculture, and other forms of sustainable agriculture, to the point where in many cases, you're starting to see a number of organic producers now acquiring yields that are comparable or even exceed conventional agriculture. So you're starting to see, I think, a lot of opportunities to come together. I think one of the biggest roles government can play are in three important areas. So first of all, I think we need more government investment in local food infrastructure. So local food processing. We've lost almost all of our small to medium-sized food processors, particularly abattoirs especially, which puts significant pressure on local food systems. A lot of our local input suppliers, our local supply chains, and so particularly in the processing sector, having more of that capacity in place will support local farmers more and support people who want to be a part of a local food system, whether through a farmer's market or your local independent grocer or whatever. Secondly, one of the things I've been advocating for is actually paying farmers to provide environmental goods and services. One of the concerns farmers have, particularly as we put price on pollution, which we absolutely need to do, is that increases input costs. Well, if you're going to ask farmers to deliver climate solutions, which we are, then I think we as society should pay them for those solutions, which then makes more sustainable practices more affordable and more profitable for farmers. And then the final point I would make is we have to look at, and this is partly connected to local food systems, is... this is more of a problem in the U.S. than in Canada, but it's how do we reduce the large mega farms? So one of the reasons I've been a huge supporter of supply management in dairy, for example, is the average dairy farm in Ontario is about 88 cows. In the United States, you have dairy facilities that have 50,000 cows. And so that's the difference between having policies in place like supply management, which protect family farms, versus just completely having a free market which leads you down the path to huge corporate farming. And so we in Canada need to do everything we can to protect our family farms and our family farmers. Yeah, so go ahead.
My name's Barry. And
Barry, we work together at Hillside. So if any of you want to come down to Guelph and volunteer.